All right, welcome back. This is the second lecture for the first unit. If it's been a minute since you've gone through lecture 1A, might not be a terrible idea to just pause here and just quickly review the topics that were covered in lecture 1A. So in this particular lecture, we're going to go a bit deeper into focus and concentration. We'll look at the effects of emotions, and we'll see about what an eyewitness is and some factors to consider when we're listening to them. And we'll also see how time can play a role on our ability to recall. So with that being said, you may remember from the first unit that I talked about the importance, the first lecture, I talked about the importance of focus and concentration. So your ability to focus just means, can you see something clearly? Do you know what the task is that we're trying to solve? Or is everything just kind of blurry and you're not real sure what you should be zoning in on? So if you know exactly what it is that you're looking at or you're trying to do, that's helpful. And concentration is like your stamina. It's like your ability to stay on that task. So if an investigator knows what and how to look for things, and they can do that over an extended period of time, it's very beneficial. So in class, right, you know, you observe with your senses, or you might remember from Unit 1, we said observation. That's going to be your ability to, or observation is just information gathered with your five senses. So how well you observe if your senses are occupied. Like if you're, fiddling with a phone, or you're listening to music, or you're letting your eyes wander around the room, or we'll see even if your mind is just kind of drifting off to other things. If your senses are preoccupied or they're compromised, that makes it difficult to make good observation. Now, with that being said, we'll see that sometimes in the world of forensics, we'll ask people to recall their observations, and it sounds like they just weren't able to do it well. But that's because their focus and concentration was on another task, and then something out of the blue just happened. So, like, imagine if I'm driving down the road, I should have my focus and concentration on the road ahead of me, other drivers, my instrument cluster, and if something happened off on the sidewalk or, you know, down a side street that I drove right past, it is possible that I would miss that because my focus and concentration was on something else. And, if someone's asking me about another event, it's possible that I might have missed it. These are some things that we'll need to consider and also work on. So in class, it goes without saying that, you know, if your senses are preoccupied or you lack focus or you lack concentration, it's going to make it difficult to do as well as what you could. So here we got a little test. Let's see how you do.
Count how many times the players wearing white pass the ball. For people who haven't seen or heard about a video like this before, about half miss the gorilla. If you knew about the gorilla, you probably saw it. But did you notice the curtain changing color or the player on the black team leaving the game? Let's rewind and watch it again. When you're looking for a gorilla, you often miss other unexpected events. And that's the monkey business illusion. Learn more about this illusion and the original gorilla experiment at theinvisiblegorilla.com.
Okay, so the monkey business, right? Anecdotally, here's what I found. Most kids notice the gorilla that walks out. That's, you know, just kind of getting a feel for what they say. Most kids are pretty good at, you know, the passes or counting them out, it seems like. They might be off by a little bit, but here's what I'm kind of trying to get at. How in the heck can we give you a specific task and then ask you something else? Well, that can happen in life, right? Like, is it possible that maybe you didn't notice the curtain change color? Is it possible you didn't really pay much attention to people coming or going? Or maybe you did, but you just didn't really think much of it. Well, I guess what I'm getting at is, oftentimes if your focus and your concentration is on one thing and it's laser focused, you might miss other things that are happening around you. And I'm not trying to say that's a good or a bad thing as much as I'm just saying it's something you need to be aware of that can occur. So we got two kids here, right? If I were to ask you what student will recall information accurately and why, would you have a response? And if you immediately have a response, here's something I would suggest. Stop, sometimes listen to the questions, and then think before you just immediately respond. Now, sometimes quick response is necessary, but here's kind of what I'm getting at. I would make an argument that we need more information to figure out which student could recall information accurately. Let's say that the task that was just given was, please get your cell phones out, watch the video that I've uploaded to my site, and then we're going to discuss it in 5 minutes. Well, it appears the young lady on the right is on her phone, listening and watching something, scrolling through whatever the material might be. That may be exactly what she's supposed to be doing. Is it possible that the gentleman on the left here had an awful morning? Huge fight with his wife. His kids told him to go to heck and back, stormed out. He's worried about a lot of things. His bills are coming due. I mean, maybe he's just got a ton of things on his mind, and it looks like he's sitting and focused on the speaker at the front of the room, but his mind is elsewhere. There's factors that we need to consider, and sometimes questions that we need to ask to answer a question accurately. So how well can you perceive and observe? I guess it kind of depends, right? We know we've got our five senses, and this is from review of our first lecture, right? You know, four of them are in your head. You can see, you can hear, you can smell, you can taste, and then touch is the other one that people often forget. In class, I'd say that your sight and your hearing are most important. I don't know of any lessons I have where you need to smell or taste something. I guess you got to navigate the world with touch, so that's something that does exist and we should consider. But, you know, if we have our senses preoccupied, like for example, say that there is a teacher that's trying to deliver instruction and this youngster is on a cell phone, at a glance, it appears sight, hearing, and touch are all preoccupied or all compromised. And if we're not really even using taste and smell, your three most important are preoccupied, I think we can agree that you wouldn't be able to make as good of observation or as good a recollection as if you were to just stay focused and concentrate at the task at hand. Here's a clue, and I kind of touched on this with the two students, but you know, looking at the picture, there's your clue. And if I were to ask you what else can influence our ability to observe besides just, you know, compromising our five senses, the little clue here is emotion. Emotions can play a huge role in that, right? If tomorrow is the start of spring break and you've got your dream vacation planned, is it possible you aren't going to be as focused on class? Absolutely. All of these emotions, or any emotion really, could have a huge factor on our ability to observe. Let's see if they affect this gentleman.
Don't say hello with these stupid motherfuckers. Hey, I'm from the South. But I'm my dad and this bitch, so I'll tear this bitch up. Because I'm talking right. I got too much sense for they stupid ass. I'm smarter than they. I'm book smart. I'm not stupid at all. Too much sense for they stupid ass. Too much sense.
Yeah, you see behind me, bitch. That's why.
That's
very smart. Somebody went to MIT,
all right? Yikes. So I don't think it's a big stretch to say that that individual was going through an emotional state. And I would wager that that emotion was anger. I'm going to cut him a little bit of slack, though. You know, he claims he's an intelligent individual, and I'll assume that that is accurate. So how in the heck could he have not observed that big pole, five, 6 feet white post, walked right into it? How the heck can you do that? How'd you not make that observation? And I think we can all agree that he was so upset and so angry about whatever the situation was that he didn't even observe that large pole and consequently walked into it and looked a little foolish. Lesson to be learned here, right? Keep your emotions in a check, and there's a real good chance that you'll be able to conduct yourself in a better fashion and also make some better decisions. So we had the luxury of being comfortable in class or our homes and watching some of these cases unfold. And we can kind of, armchair quarterback, if you will, where we can say, oh, I would have done this. You know, that guy pulls that gun in my face and I'd swat it. And then I'd grab this pot of coffee and smash him in the head, perhaps. But, you know, the reality is we don't really always know how well we'll respond or how we'll respond. Even if sometimes we've got training, we've played out scenarios in our head, if you're thrust into a life or death situation immediately, you just don't necessarily know how you'll respond. You know, this poor individual maybe was thinking about his kids and getting home safe, and the next thing you know, he's got a gun in his face and he's worried about whether or not he's going to live to see the end of his shift. We don't know how we're going to respond a lot of times unless we're thrust in that situation. So cut some people some slack when we're sitting and comfortably in our chairs and we're saying what they should have done or how they would have responded or pretending that we know exactly how it would have unfolded. So I'm kind of painting a picture that like emotions hurt your ability to observe. They're always bad. You know, you're going to walk into a big tall post or you're just going to freeze up because somebody puts you in a life or death situation or, you know, you can't pay attention because you're ready to go on your big vacation. And that's not really the way it works out. It turns out sometimes emotions can really help your ability to recall. So here's an example. That's my firstborn, my daughter, Leia, and she was born on Christmas Eve. And as I speak, I'm 43 years old, and I've experienced quite a few Christmas Eves, and I don't remember them all. That one, I remember very vividly. Why? Well, something special happened. And what I'm trying to get at here is sometimes you can be in an emotional state, and it solidifies every single little detail. That can be good or bad. There's some people who are in traumatic situations, and they just can't erase memories that they wish that they could. There's other people that, wish they could remember things that they can't. So there's scenarios where positive, or what we would usually associate as positive emotions, help or hurt our ability to recall information or make observation. And then there's like some negative emotions, like fear or anger that, maybe hurt or help our ability to recall things as well. It's weird how it works out. And, the mind's a tricky thing. So just to kind of review. And a lot of this is delving back into our first lecture. I hope you're at a spot, though, to where if I say, hey, man, what's observation? You think of our working definition. Observation is information we gather with our five senses. And if I were to ask you, what are those five? You'd say, there's four on my head. I can smell, I can taste, I can hear, I can see, and the fifth is touch. And if I said, what's perception? And you said, well, that's like my opinion. I'd say, okay, cool, I agree with that. However, our working definition of perception is your personal interpretation of those observations, which is really just kind of a fancy way of saying it's your opinion of information you've gathered, right? Okay, you can pause this if you'd like, but you should be able to spot nine faces. I love dogs, but not dog faces. There are nine faces hidden in this picture. And like I said, if you want to pause it and look around, that's fine. If not, I'm just going to move through with my cursor here and try to help you out. Large face, right in the middle. Big head, right? Bald. There's the hair, nose, mustache. And it looks like he's got a beard. One. Older gentleman, making up the nose. That's his right arm. His left arm's almost kind of like in this little sling, but then he's got a cane here, wearing it appears to be like a sombrero. Woman, there's her dress, holding a child. Boop, jump over here. Got a face off towards the side here, right? There's the nose and the chin, the neckline, hair where this like kind of grass or whatever here is wispy on the side. Looking off in this direction, we got like a profile shot. Baboom, jump over to this side. Little decorative newel post. Got another face kind of hidden in here. There's the eye looking in this direction. It's like a profile. Bird sitting on the newel post. Looks like another bird off in the background. Oh, wait, that's an eye looking off into this direction. And then there's the nose line and the mouth and chin. Two more faces hidden here. One's looking directly at us. There's their right eye and their left eye, nose and mouth. And then on the other edge of this newel post, we've got another face that's looking off in that direction. There's the nose, lips, chin, and neckline. So what am I getting at here? if I say, hey, man, there's 9 faces there, find them, and you're focused and you're concentrating, sometimes it's still tricky. And in forensics, and sometimes real world too, right? Things can get a little bit more complicated than just trying to find something that we know is there, because people sometimes try to cover up information. So these are some things to kind of consider. Oof. Clowns, right? Excuse me. Go back here. Clowns, right? People have different feelings on clowns. Some people think they're happy, jolly, hire them out for children's birthday parties and entertainment. Some people think of Stephen King's It and just demonic, creepy. Oof. So if I had a clown at my child's birthday party to entertain children, I betcha that there would be way different ends of the spectrum of how people felt about that. Some might say, oh, it's fantastic. There's live entertainment. And the entertainer was wonderful with the children and balloon animals and jokes and comedy. And some people might think, oh, monstrous, creepy. I kept my child at my side. I was just giving me the willies the entire time we were at the birthday party. So some people feel clowns are happy. Some people feel clowns are creepy. And if you talk to people at that exact same event, you might hear crazy different stories. So is there ways that you can sift through all that? There is. First, I think you should be aware that people oftentimes give you their perception. And you can kind of think, is this opinion I'm getting or fact? But if you're in the position where you can ask questions, make sure that they could be responded by with fact. So here's kind of what I mean by that. If I had to describe this individual and I said, you know, describe his nose, large red circle. There's nothing there that I really said that I think, like, you know, gives you a background information on my perception of clowns. If I were to say that, you know, he had large arched eyebrows or, you know, pale white skin or was bald on top or, you know, long red hair off towards the side. Those are really just kind of stating fact versus giving you my perception. So hopefully we can develop the skill of listening to people speak and ask ourselves, is this opinion or is this fact? And also becoming a little bit more efficient with gathering information so that we're sifting out fact and not just, you know, jumbling through people's opinion. Okay, back to this. Who's the criminal? A lot of people think it's a no-brainer, right? The guy on the right. A lot of people don't like cops. They got problems with them. They've seen them in the news. They're all crooked. Guy on the left. Do we have any evidence here to suggest that either, neither, both are criminals? I don't think so. I understand that, you know, historically speaking, in movies and, you know, stories, that the biker off here on the right must be a bad guy. Look at him. He looks like a tough guy. He's all trouble. Tattoos. Whoa. Probably riding around on a motorcycle. For all we know, this picture was taken while this individual was donating their time to read stories to sick children. You know, police officers, they've got, you know, mixed reviews too, right? Some people know that they're out there risking their life trying to do good for the community and protect us from bad folk. And some people think that they're all just on the take and roughing us up. Now, do people come up with these types of situations from, you know, past experiences and then kind of use that to guide their actions? Sure. You know, if you've got a biker uncle that's your favorite family member, that might change your perspective of the gentleman on the right. Or if you had a bad experience with a police officer, that might change your experience with, you know, the person on the left. I guess what I'm getting at is we don't have any reason to suspect that either of these guys or both these guys or neither of these guys is good, bad, or in between just from looking at a photo. Okay, with all that being said, right, who's the criminal here? Look closely. It's the same dude. So with that being said, does the guy on the right look like a doctor? If someone asks me that, I'm going to say yeah. Or the guy on the left, which, you know, again, same individual. If I take my children to go see their pediatrician and someone walks in with a tank top on and blue jeans, I'm going to be a little bit concerned. But I also understand that if I go out in the hallway and come back into a classroom with a lab coat on and a stethoscope around my neck, that doesn't necessarily mean that I've earned a medical degree. So be careful, ask some questions, try not to, you know, just assume too much when we move forward with, you know, life and this class in general. All right, got to get a new definition in our books or in our notes here, right? An eyewitness. I don't like the word, and I'll tell you why. it's a little bit misleading. You know, if I say eyewitness, I get that we see with our eyes, and that leads people to believe, well, an eyewitness is someone who's seen something. Yeah, but we're going to expand that definition. We're going to say an eyewitness is someone who's observed something. So we know now observations, information gathered with your five senses, not just something you've seen. And they can also communicate those facts. So whatever they've pulled in, the information they've pulled in, and they can tell someone else that, that makes an eyewitness. And it turns out there's a lot of factors that we should consider whether the eyewitness is accurate or inaccurate, or perhaps their past perceptions have some biases. There's things that we should consider as we listen to them throughout the class, and I think also gathering information in life in general. So those of you who have seen The Dark Knight, you know the Joker, right? If you haven't, it's a good film. My opinion, good film, right? Someone else might watch it and hate it. Anyways, the Joker's got some very, very, shall we say, different views on society and working with law enforcement and the way that things should be ran or handled. I think those are some things to consider. So I'm going to jump, and if I had to pick one, I'd say a bad eyewitness because of all these preconceived concepts of the way that society should work. Does that mean that there's no way that we could get factual information from this individual? Not at all. So I suppose it kind of varies from case to case, but you know, if I got to pick one, good or bad, I'm going to go bad because I'm worried about him, you know, not communicating clearly what it is that's a good for the case. Good or bad eyewitness? Guy's blind. He's got a seeing eye dog walking across the street with a stick. Can't see a thing. Good or bad eyewitness? Well, let's open up our definition of eyewitness, right? That's going to be someone who's observed something. So can he make observations? Cash, you can't see. I understand that. Can he hear? Can he see? Can he smell? Can he taste? Yes. So let's say that the cops talk to this guy and he's like, I'm pretty sure that they're two guys that were popping out of a truck. And I think the truck was diesel because it had a loud diesel sound and I smelled diesel fumes. I heard two male voices shouting at each other and doors slam and the truck raced off into that direction as he points off towards the west. Is that information that may be of value? Sure. So eyewitness, it's not just seeing, right? It's all those five senses. Your ability to observe comes from more than just sight. Oof, Adolf, did he have some biases? Is that something we should consider? Could he give us factual statements? Yeah, he could give us factual statements, but I think that if someone's racist or biased or whatever towards a certain group of people, that's something we should consider. Imagine if I hate teenagers. Kids, I don't hate teenagers. I love you. But imagine if I hate teenagers and I walk up to Crestwood High School and there's kids all hanging out in front of the school and somebody says, well, how was your visit? I might say, oh, it's awful. There's just a bunch of roughneck punks out front looking to cause trouble. I got a bad vibe from them, and I felt fearful the entire time I was there. Is that accurate? Or were kids just being kids, and I walked into a building? So, you know, again, we want to make sure that we're separating perception from fact. And if you have the luxury of asking the questions, and you take a little bit of thought and a little bit of practice, you can get pretty good at getting fact and sifting out and leaving behind the opinion. Oh, my mans. Are his senses preoccupied? Yes, yes, indeed they are. I tried to find a picture where all five were preoccupied, right? The sights at the phone, touch, smell, taste, hearing. Now, does that mean that there is no way he could have made a good observation or be able to communicate some information of value? No, but you know, I was looking again for a picture where we could at least hopefully agree that his ability to observe has been greatly decreased. All of his senses are preoccupied here, are compromised. But again, that doesn't mean that he might not be able to give us the certain information we're looking for. If I said, hey, what time did that text come through? That might be something he's really good at. If I said, what happened outside your driver's side window? Maybe not so much, but hopefully you see where I'm headed with this. So when we're making observation, we're gathering information, you know, again, this is kind of dipping back into that first lecture, but it's something that's important, not just in forensics, but life in general. Don't make judgments until you've gathered information. Let the information tell you what to decide. And I get that as you're watching a case or you're listening to a scenario, it's human nature to figure out what happened. But if you think, oh, this is what must have happened, and then you try to find facts to fit that, to make sense of it, you can warp or bend the truth to confirm your original guess. And you don't want to guess here, right? You want to make an informed, logical decision. So with that being said, it's just kind of a reminder. You need to make sure that you listen and gather information, let the information tell you what probably happened, pull that together, then make your judgment. Last slide here, and this goes through time. Here's the deal. A lot of times kids will think, oh, the more time I have to think on something, the better the decision I'll make. That's true, but here we're kind of talking about eyewitness accounts. And it turns out that time actually hurts people's ability to recall information. Imagine right now, you know, if we're in second trimester, I said, oh, kids, there was a problem. You've got to retake your first trimester final exams. We'll just get them out of the way right now. You studied for them. You should do fine, right? No, of course you're not going to do as well. You know, you've lost some of those details. Or if there's a fight in the lunchroom on a Friday and you're talking to people about it over the weekend and, you know, the social media is just all ablaze and there's all these theories and kids think they know and no, I talked to them and you're hearing all these different versions and your brain's meshing those together to try to figure out exactly what happened. Turns out it's pretty tricky to pull that apart. And then if I were to go and ask kids on Monday, man, what happened in the lunchroom? It's difficult to separate from what actually happened and what they think happened and what they heard happened. And as those things get meshed together, information kind of gets watered down, if you will. So time hurts in our ability to recall. There's a show, it's called The First 48, and it just goes through the importance of investigators solving crimes in the first 48 hours because they know that evidence gets lost and people's ability to recall gets worse and worse and worse. Now, you may be looking at the picture there. What's going on with He-Man? Well, when I was a kid, He-Man was one of my favorite shows, and I'd watched it, and I loved it, and I had all the figures. So fast forward to an adult. This is a few years ago when DVDs were a thing. I was gift shopping, and they had the complete full season of Masters of the Universe, season one. It was like for $5 or something. I was like, oh my goodness, I loved this show when I was a kid. So I bought it. I went to watch it, and I couldn't even get through the first episode. It was terrible. Does that mean that Masters of the Universe changed? Did somebody go back and doctor up the first episode because, you know, they wanted to make it worse? No, it was the same thing. What changed? Me, my perceptions. You know, it turns out the things that I like as an adult aren't the same that I liked as a child. Now, many of them are, but Masters of the Universe is just the exception. So again, long story short here, time, no bueno. It's bad. It hurts our ability to recall. And that is the second lecture of Unit 1. As always, you know, you got questions, concerns, please feel free to see me after class, shoot me an email, or leave a comment below. Until we meet again, bye-bye.